We saw in the Foundation 2 tutorial how bonding can lead to charges, partial charges, or no charges on the atoms involved. Ionic bonds are the result of full charges. Polar covalent bonds result in partial charges, and nonpolar covalent bonds result in no charges. And charges, whether full or partial, are attracted to each other, similar to the way in which a magnet is attracted to the opposite magnet. Let's see how this applies to hydrophilicity and hydrophobicity. Say we have water. Because of polar covalent bonds, each water molecule has partially charged atoms. The hydrogens are partially positive, and the oxygens are partially negative. Water molecules will orient themselves so that the partially positive hydrogens can interact with the partially negative oxygens of neighboring water molecules, forming hydrogen bonds. This is favorable because the opposite charges are allowed to come together, just like it's favorable for the two opposite magnets to come together. When a molecule interacts favorably with water, it's called hydrophilic, which means water-loving. Molecules made primarily of atoms with full or partial charges are typically hydrophilic, because their charges are attracted to the partial charges of water. These are polar molecules, because different sides of the molecule have opposite charges. For example, say we put table salt, sodium chloride, into this water. Sodium is positively charged, so it's attracted to the partially negative oxygen atoms. And chloride is negatively charged, so it's attracted to the partially positive hydrogen atoms. Water molecules reorganize to maximize these favorable plus-minus interactions. While sodium and chloride are no longer interacting with each other, the number of interactions they have with water is even more favorable. Now imagine that we put nonpolar molecules into this water. An example of a nonpolar molecule is octane, which is found in gasoline and is made up of only carbon and hydrogen atoms. Remember that carbon and hydrogen have very similar electronegativities, so they form nonpolar covalent bonds. As a result, the atoms in octane are uncharged. Molecules made primarily of uncharged atoms are typically hydrophobic, which means water-fearing. We'll see why these molecules fear water or don't interact favorably with water. Here we have a molecule of octane surrounded by water molecules. Instead of drawing out all the atoms in octane, I've drawn it as an oval, but it represents all of those carbons and hydrogens. Everywhere that a water molecule, with its charged hydrogen and oxygen atoms, is next to octane, it's not getting any favorable interactions with other water molecules. There are some very weak interactions that can be induced between water and octane, but these interactions aren't nearly as strong as hydrophilic interactions such as hydrogen bonds. In other words, the atoms of water that are next to octane are foregoing favorable interactions with other partially charged atoms. If octane weren't there, all the atoms of water would have favorable interactions. But because octane is there, some atoms of water forego those favorable interactions. Say we have a bunch of octane molecules in our water. When dissolved in water, the octane molecules are totally dispersed and not clumped together. Notice how many places the water has to forego favorable interactions because it's forced to be next to uncharged octane. Everywhere along the surface area of octane, we see atoms of water that don't get favorable interactions. If all of the octane molecules are clumped together into a big mass of octane, we decrease the surface area of octane so that fewer water molecules must forego those favorable interactions. This maximizes the favorable interactions between water molecules, and it also allows for some subtle favorable interactions between octane molecules. This is called the hydrophobic effect. A hydrophobic molecule like octane will not dissolve in a hydrophilic solution like water in order to decrease surface area to maximize favorable interactions between water molecules. We see this all the time. Think about salad dressing, made up of oil and vinegar. Vinegar is hydrophilic. It has polar covalent bonds. Oil is mostly hydrophobic. It's made up of a lot of carbon and hydrogen bonds. When you mix oil and vinegar, you'll get the oil dispersed throughout the vinegar, but over time they'll separate in order to decrease the surface area of the oil molecules and maximize favorable interactions between vinegar molecules. How does this relate to hemoglobin and sickle cell anemia? Hemoglobin is a big protein made up of 2 alpha and 2 beta amino acid chains. Check out the amino acids and protein structure tutorial for a preview to proteins, which are covered later. Red blood cells contain hemoglobin. Each cell has lots of hemoglobin proteins, and the inside of cells is primarily made up of water and other hydrophilic molecules. So do you think the surface of hemoglobin is hydrophilic or hydrophobic? It's hydrophilic, and it must be in order for hemoglobin to be dispersed throughout the cells. The hydrophobic parts are tucked into the inside of the protein so they don't have to interact with water. This is a general principle that applies to proteins. If the protein exists in the watery, hydrophilic environment of the cytoplasm, then its surface will be hydrophilic to interact favorably with water, while the hydrophobic parts are tucked inside, away from the watery environment. In sickle cell anemia, one mutation in the beta chain leads to a different surface amino acid. In this mutation, one glutamic acid, which is hydrophilic, is replaced by valine, which is hydrophobic. The normal hemoglobin is the one with glutamic acid, and it's called HbA. The mutated hemoglobin, which has a valine instead of a glutamic acid in each beta chain, is called HbS. When HbS isn't carrying oxygen, both beta chains have a valine exposed to the cellular environment instead of a glutamic acid. Just like we saw with octane, having hydrophobic parts exposed to water forces neighboring water molecules to forego favorable interactions whenever they interact with that exposed valine. To maximize favorable interactions, the hydrophobic effect decreases the surface area of hydrophobic molecules by clumping them together. If one HbS clumps with the neighboring one, so that their hydrophobic valines are next to each other, then water doesn't have to interact with those hydrophobic parts, and instead, water can interact with other partially charged water molecules. This is what happens in sickle cell anemia. The deoxygenated HbS proteins form a long, clumped chain to keep those hydrophobic parts from interacting with water. Here's a normal red blood cell with glutamic acid on the surface of HbA interacting well with the watery environment of the cell. The hemoglobin proteins are dispersed throughout the cell. In sickled cell anemia, the deoxygenated HbS proteins clump together to decrease hydrophobic surface area. As you've seen in lecture, these chains get so long that they push on the red blood cell membrane, distorting it into the shape typical of sickle cell anemia.